Hello, everybody, and welcome to Late Night Football. Welcome to what we can now officially call our weekly show, because we've now done it in a week for a week. We've done it last week, and now we've done it this week, so we can now call it a weekly show. Now, the next challenge, of course, is to make sure we do it every week. We'll come to that, but Kania, welcome back on the show. Always nice to have you.
Thanks, Rohit. And yeah, it's good to kind of do it twice at least now.
It's wonderful, isn't it? Yeah, and we just hopefully we can keep this going. The next step now is to think of a name. That's what we have to think about.
Yeah.
But, anyway, we'll continue with that. All those discussions, of course, we'll do that. But we're here today, and we're going to talk very interesting, because we always talk about the Premier League. We talk about the review for the weekend. By the way, we will do a review and a preview show on Friday, maybe. We might do that. I've left that one away, because quite frankly, after what happened yesterday. The wounds are too raw, I feel. We'll talk about that. But we do talk about the Premier League a lot, and something that's gone under the radar a little bit this season, at least for us. I'm sure a lot of people are talking about it, is the Serie A and how great it's been this season. It's been amazing. It's been probably the best league this season. I'm not saying overall, I'm saying this season. I think it's been the best league to watch. Again, maybe not the best league in terms of quality, all of that things, but it's been the best league to watch and follow, because it's so tight. We'll go through that. Just very quickly, I wanted to go through the tables as well, just so we can see what we're talking about, because right now, at this moment now, there's a three-way title race, Inter, Napoli, and why does this keep happening? Seriously. So we got Inter, Napoli, and AC Milan, who are locked just 1 point between them, although Inter have played a game less. There is that, but it's just 1 point between those three teams. Inter play Napoli next, by the way, very interesting one.
Yeah.
That's there. And then, of course, you've got Juventus, Atlanta, Lazio, probably Roma as well. Four teams fighting for that fourth spot. So it's very interesting that there is such competition. I'm getting it. And for about 7, 8, 9 years, Juventus just dominated. And it's almost like, when a big giant falls and all of these others are kind of scrambling to go, well, it's me. It feels like that, doesn't it? A little bit after, since Juventus fell away a little bit, and now there's this whole competition that's opened up. Oh, and I have lost Kania. I think it's been frozen. So, there we go. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I was saying, I think you might have missed it because you're frozen, but I was saying, since Juventus fell away, there's like all this, so suddenly there's all these new teams that have now come up, or maybe Juventus have been dragged down the level. Maybe the other teams have stepped up. But suddenly it's now becoming as competitive as it was maybe 30 years ago, 20 years ago. Still having internet issues there. If this continues, I may have to answer my own questions. we'll give it. All right. Yeah. I mean, having internet issues, but yeah, we're back here. What do you think?
Yeah.
All of a sudden become competitive like it was 20 years ago?
Yeah, but it's like a rise and fall of the giants, as we've always seen that to be cyclic in a way. Juventus have had a great run, as you've said, like 7 years just dominating everything. Their only negative is not winning the Champions League, mm-hmm. in that sense, and trying to kind of almost fall out every time, right there. I think they were in finals two times.
Yeah.
And
finals, yeah.
In the last 7 years.
Nine titles in a row.
Just not kind of being consistent about it.
Mm-hmm.
So it just feels a little weird in a way for them.
And yeah, it does. Yes, you did mention cyclical. I think it's one of those things, right, where sometimes you have one team that's dominated for so long, they fall away, and then it all of a sudden opens up the door for other teams. We're waiting on that happening in the Bundesliga. That has happened, by the way, yet. I don't know when it will happen. It will happen, but when it will happen, nobody knows about that. But Juventus won away. Let's talk about the teams as well. AC Milan, by the way, and we'll get to Juventus later, because that's an interesting one as well. AC Milan, a team that has had so many issues, I think, for the past, I think, since from 2011, when they last won the title, probably for the next 7, 8 years, I think they were just they were a mid-table team, actually. It's not even surprising that they were in and out of the Europa League. They didn't make the Champions League quite often. And now suddenly Stefano Pioli is in a great job. He's revitalized this team. They seem, I mean, last season they had a pretty good run last season. I don't think they were challenging for the title. They were in the top four. Now this season they look like they're in the title race as well. I mean, it's amazing how the transformation for the team is.
But it's also about the players that they have now. Like the desire, like they've tried so hard, and like they're not a bad team. They just have had a bad couple of seasons, I would say. Like missing on you know, close games, just kind of losing on to, you know, games that they should have won over the last season. I think that was kind of what I felt about it. But then it's more like also holding on to players, holding on and kind of starting with that momentum. Italian leagues are generally very passionate or like very, very charged emotionally. Mm. Like they're like the whole throughout the group in a way. Yeah. And then Milan, you know, they've had a legacy. And they've tried to, so the supporters have always been like, you know, why are we missing out on Champions League, or what's gone wrong in a way? And they've taken some time to it as well. Like they've had a couple of managers as well. I think Gattuso was the last that got sacked. And, you know, since Pioli has come in, he's kind of steadied the boat a little. And of course, you know, the players, I would say, getting Giroud, you know, he has been, I think, a main target man. And that's been kind of very interesting to see a lot of Premier League players kind of going to the Italian League, actually shining or doing better that they would have been expected. People would have not expected to kind of even hold on to their positions here. But then kind of being the main player for the team, or kind of and it's really good. And also, you know, yeah, Zlatan is here, so you know, and then
Benacer, I think, has been a revelation this season. I think for a lot of people have said Benacer. I'm not gonna pretend that I've watched a lot of the games, but no. Benacer is someone who's really caught the eye as well for a lot of people. He's been good. Tomori has been there as well. He's kind of another Premier League player who's gone there. And I know Chelsea fans keep cursing the fact that he's gone there for such a low fee, but he's there as well. So it's a lot of Premier League players. Yeah, a lot of Premier League players in ex-Premier League players in Serie A now, which is kind of nice actually, which is very good. Milan, I think, doing well. Speaking of Milan clubs, Inter Milan had a bit of a summer of turmoil. You know, lost Lukaku, which some might say was actually a good thing. I mean, Chelsea fans would probably be more. I mean, Chelsea and Lukaku and Inter, right? I mean, but yeah, they lost Lukaku. They lost, I believe, Hakimi as well, left this season, I think. Yeah, Hakimi left as well. And then, of course, Conte said, yeah, that's it. Fuck, I'm out of here. So he left as well. So a lot of turmoil. But they've kind of come back. They had a bit of a slow start. And they probably still are not fully there. I think they still draw or lose games that they should win too often for title challenge. But they're there. They're at the top of the league. They're still probably favorites to win it. It's a transformation. Again, another team. Inter probably were worse than Milan at one point. You know, even worse shape. But they've somehow transformed it. So Conte transformed it. Came in, completely changed, revamped the team. And now you've got... Inzaghi, who's doing the same. Not Filippo Inzaghi, his brother, Simone Inzaghi, who's doing a great job again, taking the team and keeping that momentum going. Again, a team that's finding its feet, basically.
So it's again the same kind of holding on to those players. And you know, it's also kind of looking at the group of players. It's also, you know, you could also say that Juventus dropped a ball. You know, I think that could also be like, if all these teams are now, we are talking about like Inter Milan or AC Milan, and then kind of Napoli being there because the gap is now created. Finally, they see an opening. Yeah. Like, okay, no, Juventus is not there, and you know, Juventus is rebuilding. So this is our perfect chance to kind of throw it all in and then see how this goes. And that's exactly what we're seeing. Like, as you said, that Inter Milan has had a shaky start. Nobody expected them to be kind of topping the table around, you know, mid-season in a way. Yeah. But they've kind of consistently won games which have mattered. Like they lost their last game, of course, to AC Milan with Giroud scoring the two. But then it's again those things like steadying the boat, trying to see that there is, you know, if you just kind of stay, on mission mode, not drop the ball, stay concentrated and focus in the game. It's much easier. And also I feel that Dzeko has been there for a long time. You know, The idea of kind of keeping Lautaro, I think that's kind of the big one for me, because he's a really great player. And then Premier League is kind of going, I think it's going to be interesting to see. He signed a new contract.
But then yeah, I don't think he'll go to the Premier League. No, I don't see a Premier League team. Well, I mean, there's one Premier League team that might need him, but they're never going to sign. It's an obvious signing that they will never make. So that he's Argentinian, right? Yeah, they won't sign him. I don't see him going to. He might go to. I don't even see him going to Barcelona. I don't know where he can go actually. Maybe Bayern Munich. Maybe if they need a striker to sort of, because Lewandowski is aging, so they might feel that they need him. But other than that, I don't see where else he could go at this point.
Maybe Arsenal. Maybe he goes to Arsenal.
Yeah, it's a price tag, isn't it? It's a price tag. If they, I don't know. Yeah, maybe if they're in the Champions League, maybe. But again, it's the kind of signing I don't see Arsenal making. Vlahovic. It never looked, not that Vlahovic is a bad player or that Arsenal are a bad club. I'm just saying it's just the kind of signing that it never felt like an Arsenal signing. It doesn't feel like an Arsenal signing. Anyway, I could be wrong. Maybe.
But also in this team, it's like with the Inter Milan thing. Also, Sanchez kind of shining back in. He's been their main man. He's been scoring goals. I think he scored a goal outside the penalty area and stuff, and there was like a 25 yard shot or something.
That guy gives me PTSD. He's a PTSD. Oh god, oh my god, you know, that's it. It's just sad, isn't it? Like a Sanchez left, Ashley Young went there, and a Sanchez, Ashley Young, then you know, both of them go and win Serie A titles in Italy. I mean, how about that, isn't it? Like,
let's not talk about the club that they came from. And I know, like, because then there's Smalling as well, who's being amazing.
No, the Smalling is like, Roma pretty much mid-table, glorified mid-table at this point. So I wouldn't
like that. He could move to Milan Inter like next season and then be like winner as well. But anyway, I'm just saying that this is they've had some good signings, and you know, getting in Perisic has been there for a long time. He's scoring good. I think Barella is one player in the Italian.
Nicola Barella has been good. And then there's the other guy. What's his name? Brozovic,
yes.
Has been fantastic as well. So,
And they even signed from Barcelona, right? Vidal, I think. Vidal as well.
Yeah, they do have Vidal. He plays as well. I don't know how key player he is at this point, but he does.
He's there as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good team. I think they built a good team. I think that's something that must be credited to both Conte now and Sarri. They built a good team. It's consistent, it's stable, and that's what you need. You need a stable team that plays a good style, and credit to Inter, they're doing fantastic. They're also in the Champions League round of 16 for the first time, I think, since 2011, which was the year after they won the Champions League. It's incredible that they won the Champions League next year. They're in the round of 16. We haven't seen them in the knockout stages, so it's going to be interesting to watch that. They're them as well. Maybe they might... who are they playing? Do you know? They're actually the only Italian team left in the Champions League. I believe that they are playing Liverpool. Okay, they play there. So they won't go too far. But
You never know.
I see Liverpool. Liverpool should beat them.
It's
good to see. I mean, I'm not really much of an Inter fan, to be honest. It's good to see them doing. It's good to see Serie A doing well. I think that's just what it is. You know, it's good to see that. And speaking of which, we've got Napoli. Napoli, they were leading the league for a long time. I just feel Napoli. The one thing that is that they're like the Spurs of Serie A. It almost feels like that, doesn't it? Although they do a little bit better than Spurs, but they almost feel like the Spurs of Serie A because they always choke. Like you always know that they're gonna choke at some point, and they did. They were leading the league. They were unbeaten, I think, for the first 9 or 10 games or whatever. And then they had this really bad run of form. They're still second. But I just feel they're too reliant on Victor Osimhen. I think that's just what it is. They need Osimhen's goals. If he's not scoring or if he's not playing, then I think the team just looks like I don't think Milik does the job. I just feel like they don't look like the team that they can be without Osimhen.
But then that's what happened even the last season, right? They kind of like they choked, I think, in the end, right?
Fourth place, they lost it. Yeah, they choked and Juventus got it.
Exactly.
We all did that. Yeah, we had that show.
Exactly.
Juventus somehow got it. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they were like, how the hell did this really happen? Like, how did Napoli, they just had to draw or something and they just
Because I think Juventus lost and Napoli also lost. And so that's why they couldn't get in. Yeah. Juventus played Milan. Milan won. Juventus lost, and then Napoli still lost, and they went down.
Exactly. So that I'm like, you could have just like so it's kind of so they're then so that kind of tells a pattern that they can't really sustain a good amount of pressure if then they just crack. And yeah, as you've said, that Osimhen kind of being their main guy, and you know, if he doesn't score, they just look average or below average in a way.
They've not been
active in the transfer market or kind of getting new reinforcements, which did
get Axel Tuanzebe on loan. I don't know how much that's going to help them. He's a good player though. I think he's a good player, but yeah, I don't know how much that's going to help him
on the striker side. I'm thinking about for the goals, where do they see the goals coming? If they're still kind of, they have one main man, I've not seen Insignia to kind of do what he does, and he's already kind of signed a contract with Toronto FC.
Yeah, that'll be interesting. He's coming to Toronto. He's coming here. Yeah. We'll get him on a show. We'll get him on a show.
Wow. Here in Toronto, lovely. That'll be awesome.
Yeah.
So the Napoli's main guy for all those seasons is now already decided in the middle of the season that he's no longer going to be playing for that club. Yeah. And I'm like, how motivated is he on the pitch right now?
Yeah.
You know, but then there's nobody else to kind of get in. Dries Mertens, how much can you rely on him still? And you know, that's almost kind of not fair, I would say. He's done his bit, he has his legacy and he's amazing. But just kind of let it be. But I would say that it just needs more. Yeah, Napoli, I wouldn't be surprised that they don't even make the Champions League, the top four eventually.
That's still a bit far because I think there is a gap between them. There's 7 points right now between them and Juventus, and 9 between them. Well, Atlanta do have a game in hand, but it's 9 points between them and Atlanta. So I feel like they should be okay to make the Champions League. I feel, but you never know. But it doesn't look like they should have too many problems. But they don't have a lot of other options off the bench, I think. So it will be interesting to see what happens with this team, because it was some decent players, but you just feel like they're missing that little bit of key element if Osimhen isn't playing.
And the next game they're playing is against Inter.
Inter, that's a big game. Yeah, they need to win that one. They need to win that one to give the competition going. They need to win that one. I think they should definitely try to win that.
And then Champions League also, they play Barcelona. So
Europa, not Champions League. Barcelona not in the Champions League, my friend. It's Europa. Europa. yes. Reality.
The moment of truth.
Yeah, I know. Can I try to pretend it's a Champions League? It's not the Champions League. I like the Europa League, so I'm not going to say much about that. But that'll be an interesting one as well. Yeah. Barcelona on fire for that one. I hope Napoli do well. I do like Gattuso. Gattuso, I remember his battles that he used to have. He was a fantastic player, and hopefully he can be a good manager as well. And then that brings us to Juventus. So here's the thing. Juventus won. I mean, we're trying, this is not really a review, but it was interesting that they won again in the last game. Dusan Vlahovic scored the goal, and then Denis Zakaria scored a goal. And of course, Zakaria should have gone elsewhere. It always comes back that, doesn't it? Somebody had the foresight to think, but these things, nobody thinks about these things, right? At certain other places. But yeah, Zakaria, I mean, those are two key signings though. I mean, all joking aside, I think those are very good signings, because the midfield has, I felt last season that Juventus, if there's one midfield that was worse than Manchester United's and among the top clubs, so the Juventus probably had the worst midfield than United. Yeah. I just felt that way. But they've kind of revitalized that this season a little bit. They've got some new players. They've let Ramsey go, which I think was good. They've gotten Zakaria. They got Locatelli as well, who I think is also another good player. Just needs a little bit of time to settle, but I think he's a good player as well. And then, of course, now they've been able to get Vlahovic. Surprised that as soon as Ronaldo leaves, they can spend 75 million on a striker. Is that a coincidence, or is that just something that?
I think that's logical for that club, because they've always needed or kind of relied on big players, big match players, and kind of who score a lot of goals, and they've always been like that. And I think that's the reason why they've kind of held their domination for the last 7 years. And the reason they could not hold on is because Morata, they can't expect goals from Morata. And he was kind of almost not allowed to go to Barcelona. I would say that, the stories are different, but then because they were like, okay, we need, if Vlahovic doesn't click or he needs more time, we need at least somebody to stay there and then kind of steer the boat. But then, yeah, he had a lot. The whole last season was like, you know, without like the first 6 months, at least without Ronaldo, he had almost so much time for himself. If people were like, he's playing in the shadow or something. So they immediately saw that Morata is not the answer. I think the main thing what pushed them for Vlahovic was Chiesa getting injured. Mm-hmm. I felt that they had a lot of hope then that Chiesa would, and Chiesa is amazing. He's a really quick player. He's a young player, and they signed him pretty early, and then he's amazing. But then it just took, it would have taken a little more longer.
He's out for the season.
Yeah. So but then it would have been different in that sense. So I think that's the reason why they kind of got in the signings of the De Vlahovic, which was really amazing. I don't think he would have gone anywhere else. And Zakaria, I think, was again a good one. But then the good thing is that they also offloaded players. They didn't kind of stick, like they offloaded Ramsey. Ramsey's now gone. Bentancur is gone, and this guy
Kulusevski.
Yes, Kulusevski is also. So basically, they've been open to kind of rejig in a way. They're basically like, okay, this is not working. Let's try some stuff up. It's not like kind of it's very difficult because people are also kind of, it's Juventus. People are like, why are they leaving such great players or kind of letting them go? But then they're also kind of changing in that sense that they're not kind of sticking on to the old ones and hoping. But then, yeah, there's one old one that they need to kind of need to know what happens with Dybala.
I thought you were going to say Chiellini or Bonucci, but you're saying Dybala. Okay, well.
I feel that Chiellini and Bonucci are kind of, unless they basically say we are done, no, the club is not going to say that they're done.
Yeah, I guess they'll wait until the end. Well, I mean, yeah.
Exactly.
They'll wait till this season. I guess if Italy don't make the World Cup, then it'll be interesting what they decide to do because, the World Cup is in December, so they probably will want to be first choice at least until the end. But it'll be interesting what happens. Yeah. And they might need a new centre back, I think, if that happens, because they don't have Rugani, I guess. De Ligt is obviously taken over, and then they have Rugani. That's about it. They don't have anybody else. So, well, they might need a centre back. I tell you what, there's somebody available in England if they want a Premier League centre back. Harry Maguire, will give him for
80 million.
80 million, yeah, 80 million is all yours. Well, I tell you what, 80, okay, somebody gives 80 cents, I probably would take that as well. But anyway, but yes, he's available. Please sign him, Juventus. You need a
You never know how crazy things are. But I'm very sure if United are able to sell Harry Maguire to any other club,
I don't think they will. But that's a question for another day. That's a question. I don't think they will sell him. That's a question for another day, though. But yeah, we'll talk about that another day.
Juventus definitely do need a rejig in the back now because they've played with them for a long time. It's also kind of how I think even in the Italian other clubs, most of them are playing back three now. Like that's the new norm. That's the new modern football, and they kind of have the up high. But with Chiellini and Bonucci, they can't really afford that.
They play a back four now, Juventus. They were the ones who introduced the back three and now they've gone to back four. So it's very, things change, right? I mean, if everybody's playing back three, then you play back four because you change your style. So, I mean, that's the way it works with football. So nothing wrong with that. But yeah, they probably do need to move on from Chiellini and Bonucci at some point. Having said that, they're doing well. I mean, they just won a European championship. So it's not like they're doing too badly together. We'll see how that goes. Are you impressed with Arthur? I know Arthur came from Barcelona, but I know he didn't do a lot. And all of a sudden now he's this main man for Juventus. Are you surprised that he's doing so well at Juventus, or did you feel that Barcelona?
I think it's typical Barcelona in a way where they're like, oh, we have too many players and we just don't want to. How do we replace Busquets in a way? I think that's the biggest question. Like Busquets is our main man, and I'm like, but have you seen Arthur? And then Arthur is like, I need time. I need game time. I need time to kind of prove myself in a way. And that's what's happened. And then Juventus, with this kind of, almost shedding of weight in the midfield and kind of allowing players to go out and, leave, it's kind of opened the spot. And he's basically kind of grabbed it with both hands. And basically, this is me. I'm going to show you now what you really got. Yeah. And he will thrive off this because he has talent around him as well. It's not that it's all dependent on him. Zakaria is amazing. I think he will feel more confident with Zakaria. Rabiot does that dirty work that, if he has a bad pass or something. He's there, but he's clinical himself, Rabiot. And then, you know, Dybala on top and with Vlahovic, it's I think it now gels well.
Yeah.
The way Juventus was playing, I think with Kulusevski and Chiesa was basically more on the counter and more on kind of running on the wings in a way, allowing more, but now they have Vlahovic, so they can go more central in a way also. So that allows the whole pitch to kind of open up. I feel that he's going to be key. What do you think about, like, do you think Barcelona missed it again?
I think so. But there is talk that they might go for him in the summer. So, I mean, I think more than the missing him part was the fact that they placed him with Pjanic. And I don't think Pjanic is really done well. I mean, I remember Pjanic a long, long time ago when he used to play Lyon, you know, when he was the young player at Lyon. And I know I was impressed by him back then. But for some reason, it hasn't just hasn't worked out for him in the way that he hoped. Maybe he made a wrong move at some point. I think he's been in Serie A for too long. But I think the fact that they replaced him with somebody who's not a CDM, because I don't think Pjanic really is a CDM. So I think that probably was worse. But I think he's showing his quality. I haven't seen much of him. Obviously, I'm not going to pretend that I have. But what I'm hearing is good stuff. And maybe he'll come back to Barcelona, because, I mean, they do need a replacement for Busquets, don't they? So he might just come back there. I don't know. Maybe there's a buyback clause or something in the contract that they can
get.
There's a Spotify, the Camp Nou is soon going to become the Spotify Camp Nou. They're going to have like Spotify playlist, special playlists for Barcelona. You know, that's going to happen. These are rumors. Yep. So that might happen as well. Yeah, we talk about so many different things, even though it's supposed to be Serie A. I don't think we actually talked about Serie A as much as we talked about everything else. but that's what it is, right? Speaking of things, Atlanta, again, I actually liked Atlanta. When I saw Atlanta play against United, the two games that they played, and I was like, I dreaded those two games against Atlanta more than the City and the Liverpool games, because to me, and I said this as well, as the City and Liverpool, you know, I think we might have lost. There you are. Okay. City and Liverpool, they kind of like, they're very relaxed, they reserve. Like, once they get a certain number of goals, City, once they get two or three, they relax. You know, Liverpool, it's like kind of like hot and cold. If you can control them, you can. But Atlanta, like full on chaos. Like, they'll just go at you. Doesn't matter how many goals.
They're the leads. Yeah, they're the leads.
Super leads. Yeah, super leads. Yeah. But when I saw them lose, and I was like, you know, I would rather lose the way Atlanta lose than the way that Ole Gunnar Solskjaer was losing. Like, I'd be like, I would like to have, because, you know, United lose anyway. So I'd rather lose that way. And that's why, I mean, and again, that's a whole conversation. But it was like, I was impressed with them. But it just feels this season that it's become too much of a, rather than control chaos, it's become too much chaos. Like, I think they've been dropping points. They went out of the Champions League when they shouldn't have. They went out there, they're now in the Europa League, they're losing games they shouldn't. Do you feel like that it needs a bit of an evolution from the tactics that people have kind of figured out that this is the way Atlanta play?
I think that
fighting for that.
Exactly. I think that's exactly what has happened. It's very like, well, if you just do the same thing like every game, like, it's just gonna be full press, crazy pressing, every player everywhere kind of marking. And there's no, and then trying to kind of break, and, you know, they are exciting to watch. I will not deny that. Like, the games that you mentioned, the Champions League, and, you know, you're like, they will not kind of sit back. They won't be like, okay, we're losing 3-0, and then, you know, let's kind of save grace and let's not kind of attack and stay back. They will go all in and basically be like, they have the belief. And it's also, you know, it's a good thing in a way that they have the belief that, you know, it's 3-0 down. We don't give a shit. We will kind of. We might score 3 or 4. And it's not that they've not done it. Like, they have previously, they have made such comebacks. Mm-hmm. So it's, they've backed themselves up. But then it's now much, much more predictable, right? You kind of go in those games again and again. People know exactly how much they're going to run. They almost always try to outrun you. They try to kind of push as much as can and press high. But then they leave spaces. And then they're like, and then they're caught out off guard in a way, or they're kind of out of position. And wrong possession or losses and stuff. But teams like these, like, you know, I can easily compare this to Leeds United, and that's where I'm taking most of my reference as well, is basically like, teams like these need, they kind of believe that's their identity.
Yeah.
So like, they just get stuck with it. But then the problem is like, how do they kind of, even if they get new players, they're not kind of adapting they're just asking the new player to adapt to their own system.
Yeah, I think the issue of those is it's injuries. Like they have had a lot of injuries this season. I mean, that's something to qualify, and I think quantify as well. And I think the fact is that the style that they play leads to injuries as well. You can do that for a season, two seasons, but I think at the third season you start getting a lot of injuries because of that. So yeah, that's another thing. Maybe I don't think they should change their style. I think it's fantastic for what, and you know, it makes Serie A more exciting. I think that's just what it is. Yep. But maybe a little bit of a tweak, maybe an evolution is needed there to kind of change it a little bit. It's like how Klopp, you know, Klopp used to do heavy metal football, and then he realized he's not going to win any titles doing that. So then he tweaked it a little bit, and it became medium metal football. You know, when they go heavy and then they suddenly go slow when they've got their two or three goals. So, you know, maybe that's something that's needed as well with Atlanta if they want to achieve success. But yeah, but what they're doing so far, I think it's working for them, and they're doing well. I think they've won a cup as well recently, I believe. And so, yeah, I think that was Lazio. That wasn't Atlanta. I'm not sure. Yeah, I keep getting confused between some of these teams. But yeah, but no, they've done pretty well for themselves so far, and hopefully they can keep going on that track. Yeah, and then, of course, Roma. I mean, Jose Mourinho, you know, they're in the Europa Conference League. I can guarantee if they win that, and they should win that, to be honest. Like, aside from Leicester, I don't see any other team that's going to challenge them. But even that, I'm guaranteeing you, Jose Mourinho's win. Like, I'm the first manager who's won all three trophies. Respect, respect, respect. But, you know, that's where he's going to go, because he's going to win that, isn't he? But, I mean, what do you make of Roma? They seem so inconsistent. I mean, at times they look like, you know, they're like, well, they win 4-1 and they win 4-0. They look so good. Tammy Abraham looks like a great striker. And there are other games where they just look like, what's going on? I mean, or Mourinho's like, oh, this team, they're playing anti football. Nobody, you know, we're being cheated or whatever. Just, you know, it's atypical of Mourinho, but there just isn't any consistency with Roma.
Like, but that's the thing. Like, I think he likes that chaos in a way. He doesn't like that consistent. He just likes that, you know, he has still not figured out the system that works right now. I would say that he got Tammy Abraham just to kind of get, because he knew he needed somebody to with the goals, and you know, Zaniolo, and you know, he wanted somebody fresh, and he wants somebody that he kind of got in. Mkhitaryan has been there for a long time. You know, he has his good days, but mostly they're bad as well. And you know, and so he needs somebody that he can rely on as well. So Zaniolo, and you know, another thing, Tammy Abraham has been a revelation for himself, I would say. And you know, Chelsea kind of suddenly being like, oh, how did we let him go? And then he suddenly starts scoring goals for fun almost. And the first half of the season, it's like kind of so many goals, and then it's again the inconsistency part of it. It's like, you know, the defensive mistakes start coming in. You know, he doesn't have a set midfield, too many tweaks, trying to figure out. So it's I feel the only good thing is like he has not still left Roma for so many jobs that were open in the Premier League, I would say.
To be fair, I mean, they were mid-table clubs. I mean, if you're going to go to, you might as well go to Roma. They were a mid-table club, I think.
I'm saying like the Newcastle thing, when the takeover came up, that he could have like, but in a way that, you know, he would have been given an open purse. So, but again, kind of like, I'm kind of going to the Premier mm-hmm. League topic, but then it's more like going back to Jose Mourinho in Roma. Mm-hmm. Basically, he's kind of revitalized them. He's basically like, this is where I kind of got my notoriety. This is where I've kind of proven with Will winning the Coppa Italia, the Italian League, the Coppa Italia, all the basic everything. And then he can do it again, but then he just needs more time. And then I think in the Italian League, I think he likes the Italian media more than the English media, of course, because it's them. I think it suits him in a way. Because he comes off more passionate rather than more arrogant when it comes to more, you know, on the British media side of it, things when he starts saying stuff like that, you know, he's the best and, you know, I'm the special one. People are like, well, he's arrogant. But in the Italian media, it's like, you know, he feels this and that's exactly what he's saying. So he's passionate about it. Yeah. So, you know, the perception also kind of matters.
Yeah, I'm speaking of which, there was a Coppa Italia game actually yesterday. Coppa Italia is on today, although we, you know, by the time this goes out, the games have probably already been completed, but they did lose to Inter. Inter went through 2-0, so they did lose that one. But I think one of the sad parts, of course, is the fact that Spinazzola had such a good season, such a good European championship, probably one of the best players the tournament. And then he's injured and he's out for 6 months and he's not been able to use him at all, which is kind of sad in a way, because having him would have been giving him more options. You know, I think he's the kind of player that maybe Mourinho would like. So, yeah, it's unlucky in that. But yeah, I mean, just looking at the team though, they've got Smalling, they've got Abraham, they've got ANC Maitland Niles as well. It's like a whole Premier League, you know, and then they've got Mkhitaryan as well.
Mkhitaryan is there, and then
It's like a whole who's who of people who couldn't hack it in the Premier League. And well, it's a whole who's who of people who used to play in the Premier League and are there. And yeah, it's interesting with Mourinho. I mean, maybe I think if he survives this season, I think next season might be better for him. The second seasons are generally better anyway. But yeah, I think he might have more success next season if he can survive this season. No idea of that.
I think top four is a stretch again. I don't think he makes top four though, but Roma. But then, if he just stays around there, that's a good achievement. If he stays, because there's so many good teams right now, and the way the table itself shows the class or kind of the competition it has right now in the Italian league. It's not like, you know, yeah, of course, it's Premier League has a much different level to it. But then the Italian league is kind of showing up. And because of the fact, I think the gap that Juventus has kind of not owned the spot that they generally are at.
Yeah. At the moment, Juventus and Atalanta are a little bit clear of the others. But with Juventus having Vlahovic now in fourth spot, it might be tough for Roma to get there. they've got one competition, the Conference League, to focus on. Hopefully they can do well there. final thoughts. Sorry. I lost my voice there.
Florentina.
Right, I think I'm better now. Yeah, that's the whole thing there. Who do you think is going to win? 1, 2, 3, 4. What's your prediction? Who's going to finish 1, 2, 3, 4?
I think Inter is going to win. Inter is going to finish. It's going to be Juventus second.
Oh, wow.
And I think Milan third. And
Napoli, or will it be someone else?
No, Napoli won't kind of finish that. Napoli will not finish top four. I think maybe Roma, if they could come. I don't know.
Or Atlanta. The closest ones are probably Atlanta at the moment. And then you've still got Lazio as well there. But that's interesting. It's a bold prediction to say Roma. Maybe they will. Maybe they won't. It's 4 points at the moment. But I think Atlanta do have a game in hand on Atlanta. Atlanta have a game in hand on Roma. And the rest of the field. So yeah, same as I think Atlanta's game in hand is against Inter. So that might be
interesting. Inter, yeah, exactly.
Might be that's a game in hand for both of them. So but yeah, that would be one of them who misses out. I think Inter will win too. I think Inter will win that, but it will be close. I think Milan will finish second. I think Juventus will finish third. I think they will enough to finish third. I don't think they will finish top two because I think the gap is just too much. But I feel Napoli might drop points to push to pull back. I know Napoli are second at the moment. I know there's the gap to Milan is much smaller than Napoli, but just have a feeling that Napoli can be reeled in easier than Milan at the moment. So I think Juventus will finish third. And the fourth is up for grabs. I don't think it'll be Roma though. I don't think it'll be Roma. Lazio, interesting. Sarri is there. He's kind of having struggles there. But I feel like it will be Napoli will finish fourth. But just by the skin of teeth, I just feel Atalanta are a little bit slowed down this season. So that's why I feel like it will be Napoli will finish fourth. But yeah, I think Juventus will finish above them though. That's what I think. So anyway, we'll keep an eye on it. And we'll see what happens. If there's things to talk about and there's things that happen, the Champions League is starting soon as well. And then you've got, I made a mistake there. I said Inter, the only Italian team, they're not. Juventus are there as well. I forgot about them. Juventus are in there as well. They're playing Villarreal. they're not the only Italian team in the Champions League. That was my mistake. So if you've seen it there, and then you probably might, you know, the odds are you probably won't comment, but I'm correcting that now. Yes, Juventus are there as well. The Champions League will be interesting. There's also Europa League. Napoli are there. Atlanta are there. And then I believe Lazio might be there as well. And then, of course, you've got Roma in the Conference League. So, yeah, there's European fixtures as well to come. And we'll see how that impacts certain teams. But thank you so much, Kanaya, for joining me for this one. I think it was an interesting sort of rundown of the Serie A teams. We've kind of done a little bit of that. It's always great to have you. And if you enjoyed this show, please do remember to like, share, and subscribe to the channel. We're just about, getting to the 500 mark. So help us get there. On Facebook, we're close to 500. On YouTube, we're getting close to 150. So please do remember to like us on Facebook, follow us, or subscribe to our channel on YouTube. Do both of them because, you know, it doesn't cost you anything. Do both of them and also share your thoughts and comments. We'd really appreciate that. So thank you so much. Take care. Have a good night. Bye-bye.